Ramanujan for G is now available on the Google Play Store. Try it out for free.
So, first, let me show you where our free lectures are. Our free lectures are here. So I guess you can see my screen. See, this is our Jnanamarga Tech channel on YouTube, and you can get all our free lectures here. So if you're studying for NEET, I highly recommend the lecture series by Professor G.K. Bhatt. There are 52 lectures for biology. Then for physics, we have now 50 lectures by Dr. Tiwari. So all very well done. You know, if you're a NEET student, you know, this is can be a very good Bible for you. If you're looking for NEET or JEE, you're looking for chemistry, we have 50 lectures there. It is all available to all the students. So you can come in at anytime, you can refer to them. Then we also have our app. Our app is, I will show you. You can download it and you can try, and very nominal price. But if you have any issues, also let us know, because we are looking for students to come and do well with us. So remember, Jnanamarga Tech, our channel, I will show you where you can download our app as well. Okay. So with that, I will then start my lecture for today. So last class, I was working with forces, And so let me do a quick run through with respect to the forces. But before that, ours is an ebook based platform, and you can download our two apps. We have two apps. For NEET students, we have the app is called Sushruta. So you go to, we have a Facebook page, www.facebook Jnanamarga Tech. And this is the YouTube link. I think, Prajyot, if you can add the YouTube link, to the Play Store, so that if students want, they can pick it up from there. Okay. So this is the YouTube link. You join there, you register, and then you go from there. Okay. So this is for the NEET students, Sushruta. We also have a higher end platform. You can take it if you want. It comes with H.C. Verma. It comes with A to Z books. And of course, in our app, all the ebooks are, it is an ebook based app. Inside the textbook, you will see lectures, So you will see a video, IIT PAL videos inside the lectures along with slides. So you can just study from one place, So that's what it is aimed for, And full slides we have for all the 2 years of subjects. You can study anytime you want without needing anybody else, So that is the aim of the app. It is to get you ready, get you going, and our aim is to produce successful students. Okay. Now, for the engineering students who want to take the JEE exam, we have this com.jnanamarga Ramanujan. Okay. Ramanujan is our flagship for JEE students. We prepared this whole slide deck with almost, we spent 1 year with IIT Chennai to prepare the slide decks. So, it's a very successful program. If you want to buy the tablet, also contact us. The tablet is also available. If you go for Ramanujan, we'll give you JEE Mains, CEngage book. Both come with H.C. Verma on the device itself, So that is as far as the promotion of our two platforms it goes. Okay, I'm going to do a quick run through of Newton's laws. So Newton's first law, we looked at it this last class. Newton's first law states that unless there is a force, there is no change in the state of inertia. Inertia, what does inertia mean? Inertia means that something which is at rest or which is moving at a constant velocity will stay at rest or in the state of constant velocity unless it is compelled by an external force. If you have to change the velocity of something, there has to be a net external force, not just external force. Sometimes there can be two forces that balance. That is not enough. There has to be an unbalanced net external force in order to change the state of inertia. Okay? Then we come to this idea of what is an inertial reference frame. Inertial reference frame is one in which Newton's laws are valid. Okay? So this is like a circular reasoning, but that's how it is. Okay? Now, if something is moving at a certain velocity and you are also moving at that same velocity, then both of you will be in an inertial reference frame. Okay. Now, remember that we are all in, we are sitting in this earth, right? And the earth is at once, revolving about its own axis and rotating around the sun, right? So it is going around the sun and it is revolving. So we are really not at rest, but we feel that we are at rest. Okay. So now from our reference frame, okay, things are happening. Okay. So then when we do measurements, we do it from this reference frame of us rotating. Okay. So that's why we are actually in a non-inertial reference frame. Okay. So, but then when we do, because everybody is in the same boat, right? Everybody in the same boat, we say, okay, now this is the reference frame. This is the inertial reference frame. Okay. So in the context of that, things are happening. All right. So now the that is Newton's first law. Newton's second law states that in an inertial reference frame, what happens basically the rate of change of momentum is the force applied. Okay. F equals dp by dt. If you have not had calculus before, I will refer you to 2-3 lectures ago, I had a class on calculus. If you see that lecture, you will understand what the meaning of rate is. You know, the rate of something is the slope. Okay, the slope. So if you plot, the p versus t curve, p being momentum. Okay, so the slope of the p versus t curve, right? Let's say the p versus t curve was like this. At every point, you can draw a slope, right? So the slope of the p versus t curve will be the force. Okay, that's what Newton's law is saying. Okay, so the derivative is nothing but the slope. Now we have to draw the slope of the p versus t curve. You may have seen a v versus t curve drawn, right? V versus in kinematics, the first thing they will do is they will draw v versus t curve. The slope of the v versus t curve is the acceleration. Okay, so now when they say that a car is going from 0 to 50 in 10 seconds, right? That is because someone is pressing the accelerator, right? So when you press the accelerator, in effect, you are applying a force. Okay, think of it that way. Okay, so now when you apply a constant force on something, it will keep accelerating. Okay. So it will, its velocity will keep going up and up and up. The most common situation is the earth is applying a force on everything and anything around it, right? So if I drop this, right, it starts at zero velocity. It will start going faster and faster and faster towards the ground, right? So that in the context of the application of a constant force, something will, it's the momentum of this body will keep increasing. The rate of increasing is constant because the force is constant, but it is continuously increasing. Okay, so that is Newton's second law. Okay, so now I'm going to discuss Newton's third law. Okay, Newton's third law is like this. Okay, if A, this body, right, is attracted by the earth. Okay, another body, right? If this body is attracted by the earth, right? So what does attracted mean? There is a force, right? A force of gravitation, right? there is a force of gravitation. If this body applies a force, if the earth applies a force on this body will also apply a force on the earth. It's very surprising, right? But that's the story of Newton's third law. Okay. So now, let us say, now we are going to discuss how to apply these laws in the context of physics. Okay. So for that, they have this concept called a free body diagram. Okay. So what is a free body diagram? Free body diagram, let me first show you free body diagram, okay, before we go to the problem, right? What is a free body diagram? Okay. Now, a free body diagram is a way of representing all the forces that act on a particular body. Okay. Now, if you see this body, right, this body, see, I am holding it up, right? So, this paper is applying a force on this body. I am applying a force on the paper to hold it up, right? The paper is applying a force on this body, right? What is the other force that is acting on this body? It is the earth, gravity. Okay. These two forces cancel each other. Because they cancel each other, there is no net force. That is why it is at rest. Okay. So that is a free body diagram. Okay. So here he has this is what you will see in the IIT PAN lecture. Okay. So here what is happening is there is a body which is on a flat surface. Okay. Somebody has tied a thread to it and is pulling the thread at a certain angle. Okay. So when they pull the thread at that angle, right, they are pulling it at a certain angle and it is moving. Okay. So when it is moving, what are all the forces acting on that body? Okay. One, mg. Mg is the weight, right? The m is the mass of the body, right? Now the force acting that the earth applies is called the weight. Okay. That is the mass times the acceleration due to gravity, g. M times g will give you the force that the earth applies, right? What is g? G mm by r squared is g m by r squared. Okay, but let's not come to that. Okay, so mg is the weight. Then there is this thing called a normal force. Normal force is the force that the surface applies, right? When I hold it together, right? This paper applies a force on that, which counteracts gravity. Okay, so that force is called normal force. Okay. How much ever this weight is, it is not going through. Why? Because the normal force is completely counteracting it. So what is the equivalent of, why is it at rest? Because the entire force of gravity is being resisted by this paper, and therefore the normal force is equal to mg. M equals mg. Okay. So then there is another force that you all know that when if you hold this here, if I push it, it is hard for me to push it. I have to make an effort, right? So like if I push my laptop, I have to, up to a certain point, I'm not able to push it, right? After a certain point, I can push it. So that the force of resistance that the table applies on the laptop and stops it from moving is called friction. Okay. So that is denoted by this F. Okay. And so that occurs at the point of contact. Okay. So it is a contact force. It is occurs at the point of contact. Okay. So then there is this, the tension of the rope that is used to, of the string that is used to pull the body. So there are four forces on the body, right? This representation of all the forces acting on the body is the free body diagram. Okay. So this is a very important concept. Okay. You should spend some time looking at some problems dealing with free body diagram and how to draw the free body diagram of all the bodies in a problem, okay, and solve some problems. Okay, initially it will be a little difficult. You will not understand all the forces. We will discuss all the forces, but as you do more problems, you will find that mechanics will become simple. When mechanics become simple, the other things will automatically become a little bit easier for you. Okay. So spend little time, invest little time understanding mechanics well, rest of it will become easier. Okay. So now I'm going to start with one problem. Okay. So this problem, there are many different things happening. Any problem, there'll be two or three different things happening. You have to learn, it takes time to understand the various things that are happening. Okay. So now this problem, body of mass M, you always read the question carefully. Okay. Body of mass M is suspended by two strings, making angles alpha 1 and alpha 2. String 1, string 2. Okay. They are both making two angles. This angle is alpha 1, that angle is, this angle is alpha 1, that angle is alpha 2. Okay. So now, these two strings are tight. Okay. So there is a tension in these two strings. Okay. Now, in addition to these two strings being tight, there is also a third string. That string is also tight. Okay. That string also has tension. Okay. Tension is a force. Okay. So if you take this dot, right, the point P, right, at that point P, right, there is a, everything is at stationary, right, but there are two forces, T1, T2, okay, and then the force on this one, T3, okay. T1 as a vector plus T2 as a vector will equal T3 as a vector, okay. So the sum of the three vectors will be zero. Only then the point P can be at rest, according to Newton's first law, right? There is, what if something is at rest, it means that there is no net force acting on it. But there are forces, they cancel each other. Okay. So now T1, T2, T3, sum of T1 plus T2 plus T3 as a vector equals zero. Okay. So T1 plus T2 plus T3 equals zero. So that is one equation. Okay. But then you have to note that there are two unknowns or three unknowns, right? How many unknowns? T1 is an unknown, T2 is an unknown, T3 is an unknown, right? So you have three equations, three unknowns. How do you solve when there are three unknowns? You cannot solve. Okay. Now, one thing I will tell you, right? If I say T1 plus T2 equals T3, what I mean by that is that these are vector equations. Okay. Vector equation means that T1's vertical component, right? Like if you take vectors, right, the I components will be equal and the J components will be equal. Okay. So if I say vector 1 equals vector 2, that means the I component of 1 will equal the I component of 2. The J component of 1 will equal the J component of 2. Okay. So remember that. So actually, there are two equations just from looking at the forces acting on T. Okay. So if you look at this, the first equation is that this angle is alpha, this angle is also alpha. Okay. So now there is this idea of componentization of a force, right? So if I have a force AI plus BJ, okay, if I have a force AI plus BJ, it is at a certain angle, right? If it was just AI, it will be horizontal. If it was just BJ, it will be vertical, right? But it is AI plus BJ, so it's at an angle, right? How do you find what is the, let us say I gave you the force itself, right? How do you find the horizontal component? Okay. Let's say I have this force at an angle theta with the horizontal. Let's say the force is T. T cos theta will be the horizontal component. It makes a angle theta with the horizontal. T cos theta will be the force in the horizontal direction. T sine theta will be the force in the vertical direction. Okay. So remember that. Okay. So now if we look at components in the horizontal direction in this problem, T1 cos alpha 1 will equal T2 cos alpha 2, okay? Because T3 does not have a horizontal component, it has only a vertical component, okay? So T1 cos alpha 1 will equal T2 cos alpha 2, okay? T1 sin alpha 1 plus T2 sin alpha 2 together will cancel out T3, okay? So T1 cos alpha 1 equals T2 cos alpha, T2 cos alpha 2, okay? T1 cos alpha 1 equals T2 cos alpha 2, T1 sin alpha 1 plus T2 sin alpha 2 will equal T3, okay? So now you have two equations, right? Not enough, because there are three unknowns, right? T1, T2 and T3. The third equation comes from the second free body. Second free body is what? The mass, right? Now, if you take the free body of the diagram of the mass, there are only two forces acting on it. There is mg and there is T. Okay? So, mg equals T3. Okay? So, you have three equations and three unknowns. When you solve the three equations, do the algebra needed to solve the three equations and three unknowns, then you will get the solution to T1, T2 and T3. Okay? So, that is this problem. Okay? Why I took the effort, and so when you solve, I suggest you draw this problem in your own free time. Draw the free body diagrams, two free body diagrams, draw the forces, then solve. When you do that, you learn about componentization, and if needed, you see the vectors discussion we had in the first class, right? Then you will start doing these problems more and more by yourself. Okay, so that was the aim in solving this problem. So now, when more than one body is involved, okay, when more than one body is involved, it is very tricky. Why? Because of Newton's third law. Okay, Newton's third law is very tricky because it is easily misunderstood. Okay, now we all know kinematics, acceleration is the net force. F equals ma, we understand, right? Now, but then this Newton's third law is a tricky boy. Okay, you know why? See, now if you have this kind of a body, right, this kind of a figure, right, you can draw the free body diagram of this, and if you apply a force like that, it is going to accelerate, right? So you must then decide if all of this is going to accelerate at the same rate or at a different rate. Okay, so if you draw the free body diagram of this, right, so you can say that it is all going to accelerate at the same rate if you keep pulling it with a constant force, right? If you stop pulling, things will change a little bit, gadwad a little bit, right? So, but if you are pulling at a constant force, right, then you can say that if you take this body, M1g, N, right, let's say there is a floor underneath, M1g, N, T. Okay, now if you take the thread itself, it has only one T. Okay, the whole thread has a T, right? Now this body, there is a T and a T2. Okay, T, T2. Okay, so there is a T pulling it this way and there's a T2 pulling it this way. Okay, so now then there is a M2G N2. Okay, this one has different N, this one has different N. This N counteracts M1G. So that is N1. This N2 counteracts M2G. So different forces will have to be applied by different bodies. All right. So very straightforward. You draw free body diagrams, write the forces, solve the equations. Okay. So kinematics is forces is quite simple. If you learn to draw free body diagram, apply the equations and solve problems. Okay, and now last class I discussed these two questions. You can see the videos. Okay, so these questions are somewhat conceptual. There are two trains, but I've already discussed this. You can see the video for the last class. Okay, so So now, and this question also I discussed last class, as I did this question as well. Okay. So now, today's class, I did a revision, so you are all comfortable with what we are teaching here. Okay. So today's class, we are going to discuss the various forces. Okay. Now, there are two kinds of forces mostly we deal with in, mostly. Okay. There are forces which are what are called contact forces. Okay. Then there are forces which occur, which are non-contact forces, which occur at a distance. Okay. Gravity is one such non-contact force. Okay. Every body in the universe attracts every other body with a weak force called gravity. Very surprising idea, right? I am sitting here. The sun is, 7, it takes 7 seconds for light to come from the sun to here. It is far away. It may be so, right? But it still attracts me. It still attracts the earth and keeps it in the orbit. Pluto is far away from us, yet it is in the orbit of the sun. That force, right, which occurs between any two masses is called gravitational force, and it is a very weak force. It is, you all know, G multiplied by, G is the gravitational constant, 8.85 to the power of something, right, multiplied by the two masses, G, M, M, capital M for the big mass, small m for the little mass, they are so same weight, M1, M2, right? G, M1, M2 divided by the distance between them, R square, okay? And in what direction, what is the direction? That is just the magnitude. What is the direction? This mass will attract this mass towards it. This mass this mass attracts this mass towards it, right? This mass attracts this mass towards it. Okay, so they are attracted towards each other. Okay, there is no charge kind of idea in gravitation. Okay, so that is gravitational force. Okay, now we are going to introduce this what is called a variable mass system. Okay, now F equals ma, you know, F equals dp by dt, and p is m times v, right? Sometimes, very rarely actually, you have problems where at the same time, not only is the velocity changing, the mass is also changing. Okay. The most common place where you have it is the rocket. Right. In a rocket, as the rocket is going up, right, it is ejecting a portion of its own mass out of the rocket. Okay. So, if you see these rockets, when they are on the ground, they will be huge, okay, multi-stage, very big rockets. But what do they mean by multi-stage? After some time, it will drop one stage. After it will first keep ejecting a portion of its mass, and then after some time, the one stage, it will just drop the whole stage, and then a smaller part of the rocket will move towards whichever goal it is looking to target. Okay, so that is a variable mass system, and there you have two. You have the product rule in derivatives, because m is a function of t, v is a function of t. You end up with dm by dt times v plus dv by dt times m. So you have two factors which give the total force. Okay, so keep that in mind. Okay. So now, rockets, typically when a rocket is flying, there is another thing that happens. That is that the distance between the masses, right, is continuously changing. Okay. In fact, even when something goes around the earth, it doesn't go in a circle. Okay. Most often we model it in a circle, and that works often. Okay. But most often it travels in an ellipse. Okay, it travels in an ellipse with the sun at one of its foci. Okay, so different types of ellipse, like if you look at the comets, they will have a very long ellipse like that. Some objects will have a smaller ellipse. Mercury is closer, Earth is little further. But they all have a different ellipse, and the sun will be at the foci of each of those ellipses. We will deal with gravitation in a later chapter. The next kind of force is electrostatic force. Okay? Electrostatic force is a non-contact force also, just like gravity, right? Any two charges will attract or repel each other. It depends on whether it is positively charged or it is negatively charged. Okay, so non-contact force, they don't have to be in touch. What is non-contact? They don't have to be touching each other. Okay, so that is electrostatic force. Then you have the magnet, electromagnetic force, right? Now, you know, you can never touch up a magnet so that it does not have a north pole or south pole. Charges, you can have a net charge, right? But you can have a net positive charge, net negative charge, as you know, right? But not so in the case of magnets. Magnet will always have a north and south pole. Okay, so having dealt with other forces, gravity, etc., electrostatic, electromagnetic, we'll come to the main force we deal with in mechanics, the main three or four forces that a lot of questions are asked about. Okay, the first is the frictional force. Okay, you must understand frictional force as having two kinds of forces. Okay, frictional force, there are two types. One, it works a certain way when the object is at rest. Okay, so how does it work when the object is at rest? Let's say this is the flat portion and there is this, right? When the object is at rest, right, the friction, right now the body is at rest. This body is at rest. I'm pushing, right? Like this man in this picture, right? As long as he is pushing, if he pushes little bit, it will push back little bit. If he pushes more, it will push back more. But as much as he is pushing, okay, he has to push a lot before it starts to move. I'm sure, I don't know how many of you, as a little child, tried to move a table or a bureau and you couldn't do it, right? That is because of friction, okay? Static friction, more specifically. If you cannot move it, you applied a big force but couldn't move it. What does that mean? That the static force is high, okay? I don't know how many of you have watched Ramayana in TV, right? Ramayana, there is this scene when Angada goes to Lanka, okay? And he puts his foot down, okay? And then he says, if any of you can move my foot, okay? Then, you know, first try to do that, you know? So many people come and try to pull Angada's foot, okay? So there they were trying to apply force, but the friction width was too much, okay? Static friction, okay? They could not move it. So because the level to which he had pushed against the ground was so strong, they did not have enough strength to exceed the static friction. Okay, so if you can exceed the static friction, then only you can get it to move. When you get it to move, then the friction is fixed. Before it starts moving, how much ever force you are applying, that is the force that is being applied in return to stop you from moving it. Friction is what stops you from moving it. Okay, so it is equal to the force that is being applied because the body is at rest. Okay, so if you see this picture, okay, the applied force and the frictional force. Okay, so between here and here, the body is not moving because the applied force and the frictional force are equal. This line is 45 degrees. Why is this line 45 degrees? The applied force, the frictional force are equal up to a point. At that point, the frictional force changes from what is called the coefficient of friction changes from what is called mu s to mu n. This is the point of mu s. At this point, this mu s turns up. Frictional force is always proportional to, not always, the maximum frictional force is proportional to the normal force. The higher the normal force, right, the greater the maximum frictional force. Okay, maximum static frictional force. Okay, so there are two coefficients of friction. Both are, so what is the frictional force? S is less than or equal to mu s times m when it's, when the body is at rest, and F is equal to mu k times n when the body is sliding. So one is an inequality in this point. This, from here to here, it is an inequality. Here to here, it is an equality. Okay, so understand how friction works. It's a very important idea. So this is the discussion. Okay, with respect to mu s, mu k, right? Mu s is the coefficient of static friction when there is no movement. Mu k is the coefficient of dynamic friction when there is movement. Okay, so these are important ideas, and you should learn these ideas. So check if the friction is static or dynamic. Problem related to friction. Okay, assuming it to be static, then the body will not move. If the body is not moving, it's static friction. Okay, and if it's static friction, it's an inequality. You don't know the frictional force. The frictional force is determined by the fact that it is at rest. Okay. Now, if the assumption is correct, the frictional force is static and hence unknown. Okay, the frictional force, if it is dynamic, you know it's mu times n, mu k times n, right? All right. Now, if it is the maximum, then you say it is mu s times n. There is a case where it just about to move, it is mu s times n. That is the maximum frictional force before movement occurs. All right. Okay. So, tackling friction, let us do one quick problem. Body of mass 10 kg is kept on a rough inclined plane. A force of 3 newtons is applied on a block. Okay. So, I'll tell you this. This kind of, inclined plane problems, they're not difficult. Okay. But if you have not seen it in your class 9 or 10, or it's not there in your book, then it becomes a little bit difficult because you've not seen it. So you must see it. Okay. Let's try some problems. Once you try some problems, these problems will become easier. Okay. So here, a block of mass 10 kg is kept on a rough inclined plane as shown in the figure. Okay. A force of 3 newtons is applied on the block. The coefficient of static friction, note the word coefficient of static friction. Okay. So coefficient of static friction is, it is not kinetic friction. Okay. Is between the plane and the block is 0.6. What should be the minimum? Whenever you read the minimum, may read the maximum. He is pointing to a case when mu s times n. Okay. Remember that. Okay. Minimum value of the force P such that the block does not move downwards. Okay. So now in all these problems, first you must draw a free body diagram. Okay. How do you draw the free body diagram of the block? So here you have only one block. Okay. And then you have all the knowns and the unknowns. The first known is 10 g, 10 times g, g is 10. So 100, right? Weight is 100 downwards. 3 this way, right? Then T. Okay. So now N, right? Normal force N unknown. Then mu S times N, right? So it is about to slide downward, but he is holding on to it. So if it is about to slide this way, see, friction is always a resistive force. If you push it this way, if the tendency is to go down, the friction will be upwards. First, you must note that. Okay? If he is, pulling it upwards, right, then the friction will be downwards. Okay. But at this point, it is about to go slide downwards. So the friction is downwards. So friction will be in this direction. So 3 plus mu n. Okay. Now n is this way, right? So the only force perpendicular and parallel to the plane in any inclined plane problem, when you do componentization, don't do x and y like that. You know, never do x and y like this. Always you do along the plane and perpendicular to the plane. Okay. So perpendicular to the plane, there are two forces. N, the normal force is at the point of contact and it is normal to the plane. Why is it called normal force? Because it is normal to the point of contact. Okay. So normal to the plane, N, normal force equals, if this angle is, if this is NG, NG cos 45. Okay. NG cos 45 will equal N. Okay. So N equals NG cos 45. Now, we already said that it is about to slip down. Therefore, the frictional force is this way, right? So, you know, 3 plus NG sin 45, right? 3 plus NG sin 45 equals 0.6 times NG cos 45, 0.6 times NG cos 45 is the frictional force. Okay. Because N is NG cos 45. Mu times N is 0.6 times N is the frictional force. Okay. So 0.6 times NG cos 45 plus P equals 3 plus the component of weight in this direction. Okay. So how many unknowns, how many equations? We already solved for N. Now you have only one unknown, which is P. All right. So that's what you have to do. There you go. Okay. It is about to slide. Draw the free body diagram. NG componentized as NG cos 45 and NG sin 45. N. So you take the components in this direction. N equals NG cos 45. Take the components in this direction, P plus F equals 3 plus NG sin 45. All right. So that's how most of these inclined plane, this, what is that, pulley, you know, rope in a pulley, Atwood machine, all these problems require you to understand how to draw first the free body diagram, understand normal force, understand frictional force, both of which are contact forces. The two main contact forces we deal with is main contact forces: tension, friction, static and kinetic friction, and the third one is normal force. Two of them are related. Friction and normal force are related. We already discussed. Okay, so this is how you solve most of these problems. Make an effort. Okay, so then sometimes you hear this concept called pseudo force. Okay. Pseudo force is a confusing thing because it is a pseudo force. It is not a real force. Okay. So this is a picture from Wikipedia. Okay. See what is happening. Okay. What is happening here is that the person who is sitting here, right? He is sitting in a merry-go-round, or he's sitting here, right? This person, right, he is watching, okay, he who is standing, right, he sees the object and it follows a curved path. Okay, this object, he sees a curved path, okay, from his frame of reference, right, from his what we call non-inertial frame of reference. We discussed inertial frame of reference where the observer is not moving, right? Now, a pseudo force is something that allows a person who is in a non-inertial frame of reference to solve problems. Okay? So it is to negate the fact that something exists in a non-inertial frame of reference. Okay? So how do you do that? What do you do to solve problems involving a pseudo force? Okay. So this is a pendulum. Okay? Pendulum in a accelerating truck. Right? Sometimes all these sort of movies I watched, I like many types of movies. I like Tamil movies, I like Hindi movies, I like English movies, right? Sometimes they will be going in this truck, it will be going faster and faster, right? But in this truck, there is this pendulum, okay? If the truck was at rest, the pendulum will be vertically down, right? Straight down, right? But when it is accelerating, it will be at an angle, okay? What angle? To understand that angle, one way to solve that, the angle at which it is hanging is, you add a minus ma naught. It is accelerating with the acceleration a naught. So you add to every body in that frame, you add a minus ma naught. Okay. So now you're compensating for the fact that you're in an accelerating frame of reference by adding this minus a. So minus ma to the body. Okay. So once you add that minus ma naught, now although it is actually accelerating, you can say that once I have taken care of this move to an accelerating frame of reference, I'm going to say that the net force on the body is zero. Okay, so now there is one extra force called the pseudo force. So this negative ma naught, okay, so now it's accelerating this way means I put one force the other way. Okay. So because it's accelerating this way, I put one force the other way. Okay. So now if I put one force the other way, what are all the forces acting on it? There are three: tension, mg, and ma naught. And I'm going to say that the sum total of T, ma naught, and mg, the vector sum of the three is going to be zero. T, if this angle is theta, if this angle is theta, then T sine theta, T cos theta will equal mg. T cos theta equals mg. T sine theta equals ma. Okay. If tan theta, you eliminate T is the unknown. So eliminate T by dividing, right? Sin theta divided by cos theta, tan theta equals a naught by g. Okay. So what is the angle it will make? It is just the tan of that angle will be a naught divided by g. Okay. So this is how you solve these kinds of problems also. Okay. So this is how you apply pseudo force. So this is another example. Maybe you want to try this example. So I'll little bit help you, but be very careful with these problems. Okay. An object is kept on a smooth inclined plane. Smooth, whenever you see the word smooth, they are saying, telling you that there is no friction. Okay. Object is kept in a smooth inclined plane. The horizontal acceleration to be imparted to the inclined plane. So now he wants to push the inclined plane. Okay. Normally, if the inclined plane, if it is a smooth inclined plane, body, it's a slope. You all know what happens in a slope, right? Unless there is a brake, it is just going to slide down, right? With no brakes, it busts, right? It's going to come all the way to the bottom, like a child in a, slide. In English they call slide. In Tamil we used to say sarukumaram, right? Slide, or I don't know Hindi what they say, But circ, like it's like a slide, you know. So if it's a slide, the thing, the object can just, it will just come down. Okay. So now this is that kind of a device. This is that kind of a inclined plane. So now what he is doing is he is moving the inclined plane. Okay. He is moving it at a acceleration. Fixed constant velocity is not enough. You have to keep accelerating it. Okay. If he is moving it at an acceleration such that it stays stationary relative to the incline. What does that mean? Stationary relative to the incline. It means that relative to the incline, it is seemingly at rest. Okay. So it is in an accelerating frame of reference. It is, he is giving a force that is accelerating the incline, right? So he is applying a force, right? So now the acceleration to be imparted, what is that acceleration? Okay. So for that, what you have to do is always, if he is applying an acceleration in this direction, the pseudo force will be in that direction. Okay. So you draw one MA in that direction, then you apply rest equation on the block. M, MG, MA. See the three forces in the free body diagram. Okay. M, MG, MA. Because it's accelerating this way, you apply a pseudo force in that way, M times that acceleration. Okay. So now equate that N, right, equals MA, what is that? MA sine theta plus MG cos theta, right? N equals MA sine theta, MG cos theta, and then MA equals MA cos theta, right? Equals MG sine theta, that is along the incline, okay? Perpendicular to the incline, N equals MG cos theta plus MA sin theta. Parallel to the incline, MG sin theta equals MA cos theta. So notice what we've done. It is actually accelerating, right? But then I applied a pseudo force and I brought the whole reference frame to rest. Okay. So on every body in the diagram, you have to apply a pseudo force. Okay, when you do that, then you can solve. So here mg cos sin theta equals ma cos theta in terms of the equation along the plane. So you can cancel the m and the m. A equals g tan theta. Okay, and what is tan theta in this equation? Tan theta is what? If this, the length of the incline is L, right, there is a one, is a smooth inclined plane of one in N. This is one, this is L. Okay, so this is what L square minus one, L square minus one square, this square plus that square equals L square. So this is what square root of L square minus one, hypotenuse square minus one, right? Square root of that, right? So g divided by so what is tan theta? Tan theta is 1 by square root of L square minus 1. Okay, so tan theta is 1 by opposite side by adjacent side. So what is opposite side? 1. What is adjacent side? Square root of L square minus 1. So g tan theta, we cancelled the m, we got g equals A equals g tan theta, and therefore you have g divided by root of L square minus 1. All right. So that's the problem. Another problem involving pseudo force. Okay. So with that, I'm going to quickly conclude today. Maybe we went a little slowly today, but I wanted all of you to be able to catch up with me. I want you to all see the three videos we have so far, And then I will continue discussion next class. Okay. So until then, what I'm going to tell you is I'm going to advise you strongly to attend Professor Tiwari's lecture. Professor Tiwari's lecture is very good. If you are going to be studying chemistry, and every student in science has to study chemistry very well, you attend Professor Tiwari's lecture, attend every week, attend regularly, and you will do very well. Then attend, if you are a DH student, attend Professor Budge's lecture. And if you are a JE student, you should attend Tarun's lectures. Tarun is an IIT student. If you are a JE student, maths, you want JE maths, attend Tarun. Or even if you are studying for state board, you have some concepts, conceptual ideas, trigonometry doesn't come easy for you, calculus is not easy, you come to us, we will take care of every problem. Okay, so attend lectures regularly and do problems. Okay, so I will quickly end. Before I end, let me introduce you to something I introduce all the time. One minute. Okay. See, I always introduce this book, Concepts of Physics, H.C. Verma. H.C. Verma is not expensive, but it is worth buying if you are willing to buy. You know, otherwise you can read textbook, you can read NCERT textbook also. See, a lot of things in physics, you should learn little bit first calculus, little bit vectors, then you must solve, then you must understand the concepts very clearly. If you understand the concepts clearly, spend time. You know, initially, you must be a little bit like, one batsman, you know, in a test match. You know, see, the new ball is there. You must give the first over to the bowler. Okay. You must leave a lot of balls outside the off stump. That's what they say, right? So, you must first learn. You must give half a 1 hour, 2 hours here to learn some videos, learn some lectures. Once you learn the concepts, then you must solve problems. Okay. Then you must, H.C. Verma has a lot of solved problems. Okay. So you can read the book. You can, if you buy a tablet, it is there, but otherwise also you can just buy the book, you know, and then you solve the, it has solved problems. You look at the solved problems. Then you solve the, some questions you yourself can solve. Okay. So slowly you build, you stay with me. You come to my lectures. Slowly you build the physics. If you are a neat student, go to Professor G.K. Butt's lecture, download our app. Okay. Prajot will send you the links to our app, and we want our students to do well. You know, we want to produce a lot of doctors. Lot of doctors. If you are going to be a neat student, we want to see a lot of doctors. Going to be JE student, come to us. We will put you in the right track. That's our interest. We want to see successful students. So please, attend Professor Tiwari's lectures, two lectures, chemistry. If you are a neat student, attend Professor Butt's lectures twice a week, and then study. You know, attend his lectures and study hard. You will do very well. God bless you, and I will see you next. If you are attending tomorrow, I will see you tomorrow. That is, we are starting the initial charge. You know. Just now starting about electrostatic charge. So you can attend that and then, you know, go forward. Okay. So keep attending all the lectures, learn the material. You have to solve problems in physics. Okay. Physics, they say, is conceptual. It needs time in the exam, right? But biology, you must learn. You must give your heart to Professor G.K. Butt's lectures. Do what he is telling you, you know. Students who do that, you will have no problem. You will go to the heights. You will be the next doctor, you know, who is saving India from coronavirus. All right, students. I'll see you next.
Welcome to the Ramanujan app. In this video, we are going to demo JEE topics and its related resources from slides and videos. Kindly give all the necessary permission and proceed to the main screen. Let us select mathematics as our subject. This will open up the syllabus for this subject. All the syllabus data regarding the subject will be loaded at this stage. Once the process is complete, the icon will be active. Zoom a bit so that the topics are clearly visible and click on the orange highlighter button. This will open up a selection box. Adjust the box so that it covers the topic you are interested in. Once this is done, confirm your selection by clicking on the green button. This will download the slides resources for that unit. Once the download is complete, it will ask you for the permission to download the textbooks from the NCERT site. Once the download is complete, it will open up the chapter and the subchapter hierarchy for the unit. Select one of the subchapter. In this case, I am selecting the second subchapter. It will load all the resources pertaining to that topic. Let us click the second icon, that is textbook. You will be given an option if there are many resources. Now you can see, it has directly taken us to the page of the selected topic. Click on the small green button to load all the icons back. Let us click the textbook icon again and select the second option. It will open up a message box, displaying the CEngage page number for that topic. Similarly, let us select the third icon, that is slides. Let's go with the first option. It will open up the slides for the said topic. Finally, let us select the fifth icon, that is YouTube videos. This will show the videos related to the topic from my IT pal. In this case, there are more than one video. Select any one of the links and watch the video.
Welcome to the second lecture on inverse trigonometric functions.
Similarly, let us select another topic and follow the same procedure. Remember, downloading of slides is a one-time process per unit. Slides are being downloaded here, as we have visited this unit for the first time. The next time we visit the same unit, slides will be retrieved locally. We can also select a topic from slides and get its equivalent matching resource. In this case, I am selecting the topic, straight lines, and getting its equivalent topic from the textbook, that is, straight lines, which comes under coordinate geometry. So here we have textbook resource showing straight lines. Also, we have slide resource showing the slides for straight lines. When there are too many topics selected, or the topic name match is not found, the list of entire topics will be shown to the student. He can select any one topic and proceed further. Now let us see the formula sheet for maths. Formula sheet is provided to get a quick reference of all the formulas covered in the syllabus. If you want to refer to a topic from the formula sheet, simply select the topic and proceed further. We are also providing a link to the CEngage app. On clicking the CEngage icon, it will open the CEngage app. You will find all the test material inside My Bookshelf option. Finally, you can take the mock tests using the National Test Appeals app. Clicking on the icon will take you directly to the National Test Appeals app, where you can try out mock tests. Now let us try out a different subject, that is physics. Let's click on the Moodle icon, seen on the syllabus screen. This will take you to the Moodle calendar, where you will be able to view all the scheduled events. Let us click on one of the events. There is an event for physics unit 1. On clicking it, we'll give a live lecture Google Meet link in it. Clicking on the link will directly open up Google Meet app where the lecture will be taken. Let us select a topic from the physics syllabus and proceed further. Now let us click the first icon, that is GyanChat. GyanChat is a medium where the students can interact with the other students via channels. Each subject unit will be having its own dedicated channel. Students can share their doubts or thoughts via this channel. Now let us click on the fourth icon, that is Gyan Moodle. Gyan Moodle would directly take you to the course material for that particular unit. These course materials will be uploaded on Moodle by the lectures. Similarly, let us select another topic and follow the same procedure. Let us click the textbook icon and select the second option. This will open up a message box displaying the page number of the Kindle version of HC Verma book. On clicking OK, it will open up the Kindle app with the book loaded. Once the book is loaded, click on the hamburger icon on the top and select the Go To option. This opens up a dialog box asking you to enter the page number. Enter the same page number, which was shown to you earlier, and click OK. This will directly take you to the page related to the topic you selected. Whenever a QR code is found inside the textbook, the student can select the QR code and he will be provided with the content material. In this particular case, we have contents related to text PDF, graphic and interactive content. In some cases, there will be video content. Let us select the text PDF content. Since this is an exemplar PDF from the NCERT site, it will ask your permission to download it from the NCERT site. Once the download is complete, it will show the exemplar. Next, let's try the graphic content. It will load the graphical resource for that topic. Finally, the interactive content. It will load the interactive content for that topic. Let us see how video content would look like from a different chapter.
Newton's first law. When you look at force, typically a force is itself defined using Newton's first law. A force is something that pushes or pulls an object and causes it to change direction, stop, change size or shape, or move faster or slower. Now, objects can be with no force. Typically, what happens is there is no alteration of either the speed at which the object is moving or the direction in which it is moving. If an object is moving, it changes direction, then too there is a force at play. Force is an external effort that happens to either a body or a system of bodies. It takes an external force to change the what is called the momentum. You already learned about vectors and scalars. Force is a vector and it has an effect on both the scalar value as well as the vector value associated with the body on which it acts. Now, there are two kinds of forces. There are forces that cause action at a distance, and then there are forces that happen because you are in touch, physical touch with the body. Now, but force in either case is external to the body that you are examining. So now let's state Newton's first law. An object remains in a state of rest or uniform velocity in a straight line unless it is acted upon by a force that causes that velocity to change. Thus, it takes a force to be applied to change either the direction, the speed, thus changing the velocity by either changing its speed or its direction. The natural tendency of a body to keep its current velocity is called inertia. When we say inertia, both the speed and the direction stay the same. We also have live lectures by world-class and dedicated tutors.
Well, that's all for this demo. Thanks for watching.